Purdue University was uniquely positioned to help usher in the space age. As a leading educational institution for technology, engineering, and the sciences, Purdue was ready with the resources, expertise, and intensity of purpose needed to face the unknown challenges of space. And what Purdue had to offer in 1947 was exactly what one young freshman needed as he prepared for a journey that would eventually take him to the moon.
I remember going to aerodynamics class taught by Professor Shanks, Merrill Shanks, and in his first, in the first day of class, he gave us an assignment at the end of the class and said, read pages 62 to 69, which happened to be Bernoulli's law, and the assignment was to criticize. And it was right then that I realized that they weren't teaching us facts and information. It was teaching me how to think. And that turned out to be extremely important in many of the situations I encountered through my life. The time that I spent at Purdue learning engineering was absolutely critical to everything I've done throughout my entire career.
The approach was analytical and exacting, not just for those who would soar into space, but for those who were preparing the systems that would take them there.
Propulsion technology got really started at Purdue in the late 40s, when, under the direction of Maurice Zucrow, when President Hovde had the foresight to say, hey, Purdue really needs to be involved in this new emerging field. Some of the very early work at Purdue and the development of rocket engine technology had to do with trying to find what the best rocket propellants were. Doc Zucrow and the researchers at Purdue made a lot of, you know, really significant advancements in burning these propellants in rocket engines at higher and higher chamber pressures than had ever been done before, and literally wrote the book that was used in a lot of the design in the early years for the big rocket companies as they developed their new engines.
So fluid facilities at Purdue were pretty much low-speed facilities for airplanes. Beginning in the early 50s and running through the 60s, we had some teaching labs with higher-speed facilities beginning in the early 60s. However, low-noise high-speed facilities existed only at NASA Langley, and so there was a lot of interest if we could build low-cost, large, low-noise high-speed facilities here, and the facility that's behind me here is the only one in the world, which is the result of a long effort to develop such a thing.
In labs and classrooms, Purdue's early aeronautics and astronautics programs quietly helped set the stage for success in space. And then, in 1969, the world watched breathlessly as Apollo flight crew Michael Collins, Edwin Aldrin, and Purdue graduate Neil Armstrong fulfilled President Kennedy's dream.
Eagle, we got you now. It's looking good. Over.
Roger, copy.
And you're a go to continue power descent.
The final descent, that is the powered descent to the surface of the moon, was indeed the most difficult part of the flight for Apollo 11, and I suspect for the subsequent flights as well. It was, the systems were very heavily loaded. They hadn't been, this part of the flight had never been done before. These parts of the systems had never been used before, and it was a very demanding task. It was enormously satisfying to get through that first one and be able to successfully make that landing. But we knew there would be a low fuel situation. We had hoped that we'd have, when we got to the vicinity of the landing site, have a couple of minutes fuel left to complete the landing. In our case, because we were going into an area that really wasn't suitable for a landing and had to extend our trajectory on to the west a direction, maybe a quarter of a mile further. It was on a steep side of a large crater with very large boulders the size of automobiles on it, and it just wasn't a place that I wanted to try and make a landing.
Contact light. Okay, engine stop. We copy you down, Eagle.
Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
And it was certainly a concern, but on the other hand, if we were going to make a landing, it had to be a safe, smooth one, and so we were prepared for that.
That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
I'd like to go back. I had to leave some things behind the first time because of our weight limits, and I'd like to go back and pick up those souvenirs.
Neil Armstrong and Eugene Cernan have been followed by 20 more Purdue graduates, and the numbers continue to grow. Purdue Pathways, The Space Connection, will be right back.